بلادك فقير القلوب مفتوحة وبضي العينين لا تنامي يما بلادك فقير القلوب مفتوحة وبضي العينين لا تخافي يما بلادك رجعي.
Welcome everyone. Tonight we have a very special webinar regarding the ongoing genocide in Gaza, where we will be hearing from Palestinian civil society. I will be giving a remark for those who want to hear the Arabic translation. اللي بحب يسمع الترجمة باللغة العربية في بأسفل الشاشة موجود interpretation اللي هي على شكل الكرة. ممكن تضغط عليها وتختار اللغة العربية. I would like first to ask everyone that we observe a moment of silence for the lives of all the victims of the ongoing genocide. Thank you all. Here where the hills slope before the sunset and the chasm of time, near gardens whose shades have been cast aside, we do what the prisoners do. We do what the jobless do. We sow hope. We have with us tonight three very distinguished guests, leaders of Palestinian civil society, who come together to convey the story of Palestinians living, experiencing, and resisting genocide. We start with a pre-recorded message from Amjad Shawa, the Gaza director of Palestinian NGO Network, who is currently based in Al-Wusta Governorate in Gaza, coordinating relief efforts between local Palestinian civil society organizations, international NGOs, including UN organizations. The message from Amjad was very difficult to attain, so we had to edit and cut and paste the video a little bit to have a coherent video, but I think he will convey a very strong message regarding his situation. Then we move to a message from Raji Sourani, the prominent human rights defender, director of the Palestinian Center for Human Rights in Gaza, coordinator of the Palestinian legal team, representing the victims in the ICC, and member of the South Africa legal team at the ICJ. And we have with us live on Zoom, Mr. Shawaan Jabarin, the longtime director of Al-Haq, Law and the Service of Man, a prominent human rights defender and member of South Africa's legal team at the ICJ. We start with Amjad's video, who is conveying the situation in Gaza.
And as I said, no one can describe what's going on. This kind of complicated, very difficult conditions, unprecedented, with full meaning. Although that we learned about other wars, but this never happened. If I'm talking about Gaza with the North, daily we're receiving alerts and warnings and calls from our people, part of them friends, relatives, who are really starving because of the shortage of food due to the Israeli attacks on the Palestinians who are waiting for the aid, or no access to these humanitarian trucks which is trying to get in Gaza. We're talking about very limited quantities which is entering Gaza with the north. Health facilities and people are dying and they are not registered. Daily attacks on the in the buildings. There is so many lives that we are we do lose because of these Israeli airstrikes. The south and the middle, it's another story. What is entering through Rafah crossing is very limited amount of aid. Before this war, we used to have from 500 to 600 trucks of different commercial items, food and other items. Now we are receiving from 100 to 150 trucks loads on such catastrophe. So you can compare about the two situations. And before the war, we were saying 600 trucks is not enough at all. And have food insecurity with about 65% before the war. Now, we are talking about people who lost their income. It's about 6 months now, and people have no money to buy, if there is something to buy. And very limited quantities of aid is entering. For example, the issue of children milk, diapers for children. If you are talking about other vegetables, and it's very expensive since most of the attacks, which is the Israeli attacks were in the farms and the agricultural area in the eastern part of Gaza. So very limited quantities of vegetables still there. And part of the things that our NGOs is doing to buy vegetables from the farmers and distribute it to the families. But we are talking about also a limited number of these quantities. So part of the things that we're doing also to reach with our health care to the people who are staying in the informal shelters. Again, the issue of medicine, it's an issue. But we are trying our best. Psychosocial support, we have different units, but also that it's an issue. I can tell you that this is unprecedented with full meaning. The attacks, bombardment, airstrikes at the same time, the cut of food, medicine, and electricity, which is really never happened. And the main thing that is not there, the issue of protection, and this never happened on such scale of killing that we are witnessing, and the injured that we about from 5 to 7% who were killed, injured, or disappeared. To tell you that first, with about my colleagues, I'm proud of these great colleagues who are working minute by minute, day by day, in order to reach the people with the different services that we can do, and the advocacy work that we are doing. The personal experience, to tell you, I left my home thinking that it would be only hours, so I just get out with a t-shirt and my pants, that's what my family thinking it will be just a few hours and we will go back. And this few hours, it became 6 months. This place as others and staying and such, we are about 40 people in the same small apartment. All of this, yes, I'm thinking about my children, but I'm thinking about also the families and children, people with disability, the women, the elders, or bad needs for. So this gives me more energy to work more and more for the sake of people and to reach the other agencies as the UNRWA, which is the spinal cord of the aid in Gaza Strip, which is under attack by Israel. At the same time, WFP and how we can influence their policies to distribution and to have fair distribution. UNICEF regarding the issue of water, issue of psychosocial support, the issue of UNOCHR regarding the protection of women, the GBV, the things we have to follow with the sectors and to empower the voice of the national NGOs. We are not only service providers or distributors. Also, we have our voice regarding different issues. My son, the youngest son, is 14 years old. He was going to the grocery downstairs. So we had big airstrike bombardment in the neighborhood. So we just get out in order to see what's going on. So I remember that my son in the grocery, which is in front of the building, which was attacked by the Israeli strikes. So I just ran towards that, it's serious. And I found him full of dust and crying and was very scared. And from that day, and he's just sleeping beside me. It's not easy mission. It's very simple to us what's going on. I have two daughters. The Sarah, she's studying in dental faculty in the fourth year. And you can imagine what's the meaning that the faculty labs and the universe itself to be destroyed. So she's saying that my future destroyed. And sometimes you have to give her hope. No, you are not alone. There is others. And the same thing with my wife. She's working with the ICRC. Dar al-Balah, she is receiving cases, and you have to do psychosocial support, stress release for the family. And in the same time, you have to do it to the others and to give hope, some hope to the others. These crimes, it's not against the Palestinians only, it's against the humanity. And this unprecedented attacks, it's not only on the Palestinians. These grave violations on the humanitarian law, on the international law, on the basic principles could be happened in other places. So actions is needed to stop such crimes on humanity and to protect the children. And we have to work parallel to protect the civilians, to stop the attacks on the Palestinian people, and in the same time to let in with no restrictions all needs, all humanitarian needs to the people who are starving or dying because of shortage of medicine. Thank you all for the great work that you're doing.
A powerful testimony from Amjad, where the personal is part of the whole. I asked Mr. Sourani earlier, what are Israel's legal responsibility under international law? And did it violate these responsibilities?
Palestinians didn't invent international law, international humanitarian law. They didn't invent the Geneva Conventions or Universal Declaration for Human Rights or Convention Against Genocide. This is the creme de la creme of the human experience, which concluded basically after Second World War that civilians should be protected at the time of war. When Europe in the Second World War lost more than 85 million civilians, including the Holocaust, including what had happened with the gypsies and what had happened with many of the cities, villages who entirely, I mean, raised with millions of people. That's why everybody, I mean, concluded war between armies and civilians should be protected. Civilian targets should be protected. Israel, as an occupying power, from day one, it tried to not to be abide by international law. And that's why they said, we didn't occupy, basically, the occupied territories. We are administrating the occupied territories. And they were calling it not occupied, but rather disputed territories. Their point of departure not to have neither de jure or de facto the applicability of the Geneva Convention who protect civilians at the time of war. And nobody listened to Israel. Nobody agreed with Israel. And everybody, I mean, agreed that this is an occupied territory. Gaza, West Bank, including East Jerusalem, since 1967. Israel, regarding civilians, deliberately and intentionally, they didn't leave one article of the convention of international law, of international humanitarian law, of Geneva conventions. They didn't violate it without exception. And all the Israeli practices shows that clearly. I will pick some issues precisely when we say settlements. It's a grave breach of the Geneva Conventions, Article 49, and Israel doing that, and they have 1 million settlers at the West Bank. When we talk about the annexation apartheid wall, most important court on earth gave its advisory opinion, and they said clearly and simply that this is illegal and should be dismantled and destroyed. All the practices related to willful killing, extrajudicial killing, targeted killing, torture, arrest of children, the incursions of villages, camps, cities in the West Bank or in Gaza. All these practices very well known and obvious how Israel violated it. In Gaza, it's almost, I mean, different story. We have six offensives, six wars in which Israel, having in the eye of the storm, civilians and civilian targets. And this is very well known, very well documented since 2008-09 by Goldstone Report and on. And Israel didn't allow one single investigative body from the UN or other bodies to come into the occupied territories. In this last offensive in October 7th, Israel did simply and clearly unprecedented crimes. And since the early days, I recall we and our Palestinian colleagues who are in this field and our international colleagues as well in Europe and US and elsewhere, we were discussing whether really what's going on genocide or not. And the nitty-gritty conclusion was simple after brief discussion. Yes, what's going on really genocide, because Israel in the two components of the genocide crime, the intent, which is the most difficult part usually. We have as lawyers in proving it, proving that the state trying to do genocide was clear, simple, obvious, and it has been stated not coincidentally, but by the top of the pyramid in Israel, whether it's political or military. President of Israel Herzog said, no distinction between Palestinian civilians in Gaza and Hamas. All are terrorists and all will be targeted. And Palestinians are human animals. Now, if a president of the state doesn't make distinction between civilians and armed groups, that means they are targeting everybody, every single body in the Gaza Strip. And this is one thing. The second, Netanyahu said from written paper, and he was reading it, all Gazans should leave Gaza. The question, where to? To the sea? To Sinai? Return back to their homeland inside the Green Line? Of course, he meant Gazans should leave to Sinai, should leave to Egypt. And the third was Gallant, the Minister of Defense or the Arab Minister. He said in simple, clear words, for Gaza, there will be no water and no food. For Gaza, there will be no fuel or electricity. Of course, he meant the starvation of Gaza, dehumanizing Gaza. I can go on with other tens of more ugly statements, but I'm talking about the top of the pyramid and what they said in the first days of the conflict, all these statements before the 10th of October. So in less than 3 days. And that means all what they did afterwards was mituchnam merosh, an advanced plan. And they know what they are heading to. And that's why we soon after that witnessed, and for me even, who lived all these six wars before, was a great shock. We saw massive, massive destruction, unprecedented by all standards, by all meanings. I can assure you, 80% of Gaza erased, don't exist, with no exception for hospital, bakery, for shelter of UNRWA schools, or even, you know, churches or mosques. They didn't leave even the desalination factories of water, which costed hundreds of millions of euros. They didn't leave the solar energy. They didn't leave the electricity factory, water pipes, name it, anything you can think of. Needless to say, how they targeted civil defense, ambulances. So the level of destruction, unprecedented and so ugly, and they're targeting not only buildings, but the patients, the ordinary people, the civilians, the young and old. As a result of that massive destruction and the instructions they gave to the people, we have unprecedented displacement. So almost 1.6 million people moved from different parts of Gaza, especially from the north to the south, and all concentrated in very small area now in Rafah and Mawasi area, doesn't exceed 40 square kilometers. Starvation, and there is difference between famine and starvation. I remember when we went to the Israeli High Court of Justice protesting against the blockade of Gaza and how disastrous it is for the civilians. The MAG, military prosecutor who represents the state, said, nobody should be worried about famine in Gaza. We are counting how many calories each Gazan takes. Besides, it's the biggest shame state like Israel can have. Right now, I mean, they are starving people. This is not natural. This is deliberate, intentional, and they mean it. They want to starve people. And that's by itself, I mean, another major crime. For days, people cannot have food. And food here doesn't mean ordinary food. Food means bread. People don't have bread. Just as simple as that. And you can look to your children, your wife, and you are just can do nothing. I mean, in this regard, you cannot protect them. You cannot even provide a piece of bread, I mean, for them. And most of the people, I mean, stayed and staying for 3-4 days, I mean, to have a piece of bread, I mean, to eat. That's why many ate the animals' food, and they are living on the grass right now, on Gaza, the wild grass, I mean. Famine, it's unbelievable, unprecedented, it's man-made, and it's a big shame for the occupation. So we have massive destruction, we have massive displacement, we have starvation. The number of killings and injuries, I never ever thought we will come to this. This is Gaza. We are talking about 2-4 million people only, and in 173 days already, you are having 37,000 killed. I was talking to somebody. He said, "I think, you know, those who died, they are lucky because they didn't suffer. Those who are still alive is the real victims." But so like killing 37,000 people is not enough. And I have to remind everybody that we are having 85,000 injured people, and definitely 1/3 of them will die. So you are talking about extras of at least 25,000 people will die sooner or later. I don't want to talk about thousands, tens of thousands with no limbs, especially children and women. Now, among other things, we have between 8,000 to 10,000 people now dead under rubbles, unable to be uncovered. So the number of killing, it's outstanding. It's too much, and I'm afraid I'm not accurate. And I hope and pray that the number stop, I mean, at this level, because most likely it's much more than that. So 74% of those has been killed and injured by the Israeli army are children and women. And this is not coincident. It's deliberate, it's intentional, and they mean it, and they know it, and they are not trying, I mean, to avoid it. So Israel didn't leave any article of the Geneva Conventions, and in international law, they didn't violate. And basically, they are targeting us. They are targeting civilians and civilian targets. I don't know why they are doing that. This generation who's fighting them now, it is the generation who lived 2008 war, 2012, 2014, 2017, Great March of Return, 2021, 22, and May 23. This is the generation who lived the blockade. We didn't kneel. We didn't give up. We didn't lose hope. And with that, and with this war, were entire families, hundreds of families erased. When this number of children and women being killed, when this level of destruction, displacement, starvation, dead people happen, they are pushing the back of the people to the wall, and they have nothing to lose. What Israel is doing, ugly, and the most ugly part of it, this is not a secret. This is not something only Gaza know about it. It's a broadcasted live, on air, at the real time. The whole watch it, the whole world watch it and know it. And these governments of the West, just as simple as that, still till this moment, supporting Israel with arms, with money, with legal political cover, US government, European governments are complicit. We are killed by their arms and by their complicit with Israel by protecting it as far and making it feel immune, and nobody can hold them accountable or punish them.
Powerful, powerful message from Raji. Shawaan, can you explain to us the responsibilities of third states? Especially after the ICJ delivered its provisional measures, and quite clearly Israel has violated all of them.
First of all, I would like to thank Bisan and also the Scientists for Palestine for organizing this webinar. Following the what Raji said and what Amjad said, I would like just to highlight a few things before I respond to the question that you raised, Dubai. One is the Palestinian people means all people. They are people and all of them, not just, you know, the Palestinians that are living in West Bank and Gaza. That's a main thing. The second one, our case, it hasn't started on October 7th. Our case started even before, long time before. 75% of the Palestinians in Gaza, they are refugees. You know, their fathers, mothers, grandfathers, mothers, they were evicted and they were pushed out from their lands, from their homes, from their houses in 48, 49. That's the case. And when some of the Israeli leaders or let me say philosophers, or let me say officials or ideological persons, sometimes when they say, you know, about the demography and what to, this is one of the main risk, demographic things is one of the main risk. And here some of them, they start giving like recipes, you know, what to do with that. Some of them, they, you know, speak about diseases, you know, against Palestinians, killings, others, you know, sending them out. This is, you know, part of the thing, because it means that the Israelis, they haven't recognized Palestinian people yet. And even Oslo itself, there is no one word about Palestinian people or self-determination or occupation, or occupation. No one word in that. This is clear. This is means a lot. They haven't recognized us yet as a people, that we have a fundamental rights. And the problem is there. The last point is Palestinians, they have no problem with the Jews. Their problem is with a political entity, the Zionist movement. That's the case. Here the case. It's not against Jews, and they have nothing with the Jews to do. That's, I think, the main point I would like to highlight it. Other thing is regarding even the case, the court decided, you know, the provisional measures, they decided six different provisional measures, and they ordered. And the ICJ, the International Court of Justice, this is the highest, you know, court in the world. This is the highest judiciary system in the world. That's, and its decisions, and here I'm saying decisions, it's applicable, and it has to be implemented directly from all states. And mainly when it comes to the, you know, the basis of treaty, like the convention here in this case, the genocide convention, all the members of the state, more than that, this convention, it's a customary law. It's applied not on those that are members. No, those that are not members, also they have an obligation, you know, to respect and to implement it. That's the issue. This is the case. And here when we say obligations and implement it, it's not just about the party who is committing the crime or who is addressed by the ICJ or the court. Also, all parties, they are responsible and they have a responsibility. And here I'm speaking about the third state parties, all parties. And when I speak about that, which kind of things, which kind of obligation, when there is an international crimes taking place or committing here, the third state parties, they have two things to do. One, it's not just a passive role, not recognize, let me say, the crime, or not, you know, no, they have to take also more progressive, positive also role to play. One is the to help to stop this crime going on. Prevention measures they have to take. More than that, also to punish who is doing these things. Punishing the prevention and punishing, this is main and cornerstones in international law when it comes to the international crimes, like war crimes, crimes against the humanity, or genocide, the prevention and also the punish. And here the prevention, they have to take actions. Nothing called, you know, prevention, just calling and making and condemning and then, no, you have to take actions to stop the ongoing crime taking place here or there. That's one of the main thing. One of that, for instance, you have to stop, let me say, trade my arms with that state. Army trades, this is one of the main thing. Other thing is also you have to take, let me say, an economic actions, diplomatic actions, other actions, even including if it needs also to intervene directly. And I can hear, I would like to say, what's going on in Yemen, this is part of the implementation in my point of view regarding law. What's going on in Yemen? But what's going on in Yemen has not to be attack or target all, you know, the ships or warships there. The trade, the international trade, it has to be free. But anything relating to Israel, feeding Israel, the military, or economically, or things like that, this is part of the pressure on Israel. This is part of the actions I am speaking about to this level, also according law. That, and here, all of the third state parties, they have responsibility, and they are responsible. Not just the U.S., also Russia. Where's Russia actions? This is an issue. Where is France actions? Where is Germany actions? Where is the rest of the world actions? I think what's missing, what is missing in this conflict is action. There is no action. And because there is no actions taking in the last, you know, 76 years, Israel, they felt that they enjoy impunity. They are over a law. That's, and here it's simple like that. If there is no accountability and no one holding you accountable for your crimes, you will repeat your crimes. It's ABC. Even in a society, for instance, ordinary crimes, if you don't hold the criminal accountable for his or her crime, they will carry out again their crimes again and again. And this is the case of Israel. That's the case in Israel. When we are calling for accountability, you know, no one hears us. And more than that, we have been saying also to everyone, mainly Germans, we said, we don't want a history to repeat itself. Could you please don't let history to repeat itself? And we meant it, and we mean it. And there is no one action. And I think this is one of the main problems. No one state act according its obligation under the international law, international humanitarian law, international, you know, human rights law, any law. That's, and I think this is what encouraged Israel to continue committing their crimes and to ignore also the ICJ ruling on the provisional measures issue. And more than that, they intensified their crimes. And when they engaged with the ICJ, they engaged, I think, to kill the case at the beginning, at the first stance. That's, you know, why they engaged with the court. And they thought that the court will take, you know, their argument, and maybe they will close before, you know, South Africa. But when the ICJ ruled on that, we saw, you know, how Netanyahu, responded and his statement. And, you know, the statement come from here and from there, the officials, Smotrich and the others, anti-Semitic and all of these things. I think if there is no accountability, the crimes will continue. If there is no respect of the obligation under the international different branches of the law by the third state parties, I can say we are going to reach the moment of rule of jungle, not rule of law. That's the case. And what's going on here, it's unprecedented. And when I say it's unprecedented case, I mean it. I would like to hear from any historian, any legal person, just to say to me, Shawaan, it's good to read this book or that book if the same thing happened. Now, I'm not speaking about the scale. I'm not speaking about the scale only. I'm speaking also about the nature of the crimes taking place also in Gaza. What's going on in Gaza? It's unprecedented. Give me in one case that the medical facilities, including hospitals, staff, doctors, others, they targeted systematically, intentionally, and in systematic way to destroy this system 100%, except in this case. I heard and I read and I watched and I know that in some areas and some conflicts, hospitals, maybe they were targeted and they said this is a collateral here or there. That's the case, some, but not systematically in the way that the Israelis, you know, they attacked that. And also they attacked civilians intentionally, systematically, in widespread practice. This is the case. Children, wow, where's this? And now what they say, you know, targeting, you know, the residential buildings, their families, specific families they are targeted. Why? Maybe because a member of that family, he is with Hamas or something like that, or with Islamic Jihad or with others. Go and kill the rest of the family. Where is this in the law? Where is this in the law? I think what's going on these days, it's losing the hope of the people, you know, in the minds of the people everywhere, that the international law, it doesn't work. The problem is not in the texts. The problem is in the political will. The problem is the respect. The problem is to avoid, you know, the double standards, the selectivity of the implementation. Because anything you have double standard in it and selectivity, this is the way how you kill the principles. This is the way how you kill the principles. That's, I think, what's concerned all of us. And here, I can say that the international system, in my point of view, failed. For the case of Gaza, it's failed. The protection, you know, failed. The problem is not in the texts. We see that well, but I think the problem is the system failed. And this system built after the Second World War. And maybe it's a time to rethink and reforming, you know, the system in a different way. One of that is how it comes. You use a veto, for instance, to avoid tackling the case of international crimes. Why? How it works this? Where is this? I think this is part. Another thing is even the third state parties showed us, mainly in the West, I can say, governments here. I'm not speaking about the people, because in my point of view, I look at the international system, international community, as two different communities. One is official and one is public. I'm not speaking about the public. I'm speaking about the official one. Mainly the West. I think the Western countries, they showed their culture well. Their culture is still, they have deep, deep roots of a culture of colonialism. This is clear. When they came to give, you know, Netanyahu green light to attack and to do what he wants to do, and they came supporting Israel, but they don't say any war when it comes to what's going on against Palestinians as a genocide and genocidal acts. Wow. Where is this? Wow. What's this human rights values? Because of that, when I ask, you know, the Western officials and the others, I'm not asking them for ethical reasons. I'm trying to wakening up their human conscience, because they have no human conscience. That's the case. I'm trying to waking up, you know, their conscience regarding the values that they do believe. If they do believe these values, this is their values, human values, where they are. That's because of that, you know, when the people standing up, they are not standing up behind the Palestinians. They are standing up behind, you know, the values and the principles of justice, of equality, of human rights. This is the principles. I think they are destructing all of these principles. Before Gaza will not like after Gaza, in my point of view. And before all of us, there are big and strategic questions that we have to address and we have to speak about and we have to stand in the right square regarding the values. And I think this is an historical moment. Where you stand? Are you standing and speaking out? Are you standing behind, you know, the right side of the history or the wrong side of the history? And there are many countries, officials, you know, in these countries, they stood behind the wrong side of the history. And I think they will pay the price for the future. And they have a big hope that the people, you know, and my hope is on the people, you know, not just Palestinian people, everywhere. That's, and this is not serve Israel. And it will not help Israel for sure what they are doing. This is deepening the hate against, you know, Israel and against all of these things. This is will not help. What's help is to say this is wrong and this is right. And to hold the criminal accountable. That's, this is in my point of view. This is regarding, you know, the first question, Obey, that you asked. I don't know if I exceeded the time or if I am on time.
Well, it's very informative, Shawaan. Thank you for it. And actually, this brings us also to Raj's second aspect. When I asked him, can international law bring justice to Palestinians? So let's hear Raj's viewpoint on this.
Obey, I think international law, international humanitarian law, and the human rights, it's not Palestinian invention. This is the creme de la creme of the human experience. And it's there to be respected and implemented. The West really racist and colonial. And they are complicit and they are part, genuine part of the crime of genocide against Palestinian people. They all are responsible with no exception. Now, in Ukraine, the two pillars the entire West stood against Russia and supported Ukraine for were A, invasion, B, occupation. So because Russia invaded and occupied Ukraine, the entire West, led by the US and NATO, stood firmly and shaken up, and they said, we will not allow this to happen. Ukrainians occupied and invaded, they have the right of self-determination. So they have the right to resist the occupation. And we will support them by all ways and means, including arms. Ukrainians do have the right of armed resistance, among other things. And they ask the free Europeans and Americans to go and join the resistance in Ukraine. They said, we are not satisfied with that. We will support Ukraine with money, with arms, and all our might in diplomacy and in the legal front. And the NATO backed them 100%. And this was demonstrative. They sanctioned Russia with 7 waves of sanctions. And they activated the ICC. And Mr. KK, in 1 year, was able to give warrant against President Putin. And a few weeks ago, another warrant was issued against some of the Russian leaders. Now, why the West, out of the blue, was aware about invasion, about occupation, and about the right of the Ukrainians to resist the Russian occupation and the right of armed struggle. We have in Palestine prolonged occupation, the short version, 57 years, and the old version, 75 years since Nakba. International community, selective and schizophrenic, politicizing international law. Four 400 Ukrainian children check the world. Rightly, I mean, of course. 16,000 Palestinian children doesn't mean anything for the world. The problem that we learned as the Palestinians a lot, and we try to use the creme de la creme of the human experience, we used effectively, professionally, the international law instrument. We showed that the Israeli legal system play as cheap legal cover for the Israeli orchestrated war crimes perpetrated by the state by giving all the legal cover for what's needed. Second, when we began to use universal jurisdiction in Spain, France, UK, US, New Zealand, South Africa, Sweden, Switzerland, we were blocked through legislation and administrative ways. And we were not allowed to use this effectively to arrest Israeli war criminals. Then we went to the ICC. It was tough, professional and political battle. We made it, and the investigation was opened by Fatou Bensouda in March 2021. And they brought KK, who paralyzed entirely the ICC, and he didn't move 1 millimeter since then till now. Genocide, genuine part of Rome Statute and ICC prosecutor mandate. He did nothing, not in this or others. Of course, due to political pressure by UK, Germany, and US, etc. We went to the ICJ, where they are standing. There is genocide in a process. There is every minute while we are talking right now, there is people bombarded, killed, their houses destroyed, pain, suffering, blood, displacement, starvation. And 80% of Gaza destroyed. Where is international community? International law is there. And ICJ and ICC showed in a clear, simple way, moral legal superiority on war criminals, do war crimes, persecution, and genocide against Palestinian civilians. So the problem, not with the law, not with us as a Palestinian, the problem is with the political will of international community. They are complicit and they want Israel to go in the crimes they are doing against us. With their aid, with their help, with their legal political cover.
So Shawaan, with all of these states being complicit from the global north and other, actually also in other places, but maybe the global north is like the ones that have more power and more economic aspects and are more complicit. What is the way forward for Palestinians as perceived by Palestinian civil society? How can Palestinians achieve justice?
I think we have to reevaluate our strategies and our work as a civil society. I think we gave more weight and we used to focus on North more than Global South. This is one of the mistakes, big mistake. And I think we have allies everywhere over the world, but I think also in the South. We haven't given any real effort in that area. This is one thing. Second, I think we haven't given also enough time and effort to strengthen our relations with other civil society bodies like unionists in different places. The civil society in, for instance, also the new generation in the universities. This is also very important and we can do. We have to look long, you know, term and long, you know, future and longest strategies more than just day by day strategies as a civil society. And I think first of all, we have to address the main questions and to evaluate, to be honest with you, where these countries, this government or their government stand. That's the issue. And what we can do jointly also with the people in this country and that country. We saw that millions of people, they were in the streets shouting, standing up strongly behind the values of equality, justice, human rights, humanity. This is, I think, very important. I know, you know, sometimes people, they have a short memory, but, and maybe late tomorrow or after tomorrow, you know, the media machine, the Israeli machine, the US machine, things like that, the German machine, you know, they trying to rebuild a different narrative and different stories. I think the narrative is a very important one. And we have to stick and use in the right way the terms and the words and to address things in the right way. What's going on is a genocide. And this system, I think, it's a settler colonial system. It's not just only an ordinary occupation. We are missing, I think, the right track when we say this is only, you know, an occupation. No, no, no. And what we are looking for is to dissolve, you know, the racism and the racist ideologies, systems, policies. That's the case. This is the case. And what we have to stand behind is the rights. I'm not to make any compromise with the fundamental rights. You know, live in dignity, live in human rights, equality, self-determination, right of return to the refugees. This is main things, and holding the criminals accountable. That's, and this is what we mean, you know, by all of these things. I think our narrative, we have to look also deeply at our narrative, which narrative that we use, and we have allies everywhere. More than that, when it comes to the practical steps, we have to use all options that we have in hand, including also the judiciary system at the domestic level in different places. Those they have also a jurisdiction. And maybe at this time, speaking about and going to submit cases to stop arming Israel. This is an issue we have to do. I know that the U.S., they continue arming Israel, and the U.S., it's not just complicit with the crime. They are part of the crime. This is a war of the U.S. on people in Gaza. That's more than that on Palestinians, I can say. Another thing is, today I saw that they have a list, you know, of, let me say, settlers. They are differentiate that they are bad settlers and good settlers. This is, you know, the policy that they have. They don't look at the root cause of the problem. It's the settlements policies. It's the main policy. And what's going on in West Bank, it's not less than also what's going also in Gaza. Here, there's, let me say, silent. And day by day, you know, that's the case, what they are doing, killing, demolishing, erasing, transferring Palestinians from their communities here or there. This was going on. This is also a daily basis, crimes here. This shows that, you know, they are targeting all Palestinians, not just a group of Palestinians. What's going on in Gaza, it's not a war against Hamas. No, no, no. It's a war on people. That's how I look at it. It's a war on Palestinian civilians, on Palestinians. That's the case. What's going on in Gaza, what's going on in West Bank, what's going on against Palestinians side Israel. This is an issue. There is a persecution against Palestinians there. They have a fear, big fear. They couldn't speak. They couldn't speak out. Just recently, they tried together and to go. This is after, you know, 5 months. This is, they arresting anyone speak here or there or express, you know, his idea or her idea. And they started with the art person, you know, the singing person. I forget her name. She is a famous, but sorry, you know, forget her name. That, I think, shows the case. Another thing is the Israelis, they declare. They don't hide. Netanyahu, his government, others, they don't hide. They don't hide long-term strategy that they have to eliminate Palestinians from there, from here. Palestinians, they have no land. They are not people. They have no right to self-determination. There's that everything. They said it clearly and publicly. We are not just bringing things, you know, and put that in their mouth. No, no, they say this clearly. I think many things we can do. We have a long way of work that we have to do. First, we have to start here and also to engage and to share this with our colleagues abroad, everywhere over the world. And we have discussions. We have to start the discussion and genuine discussions. Another thing is when it comes also to the funding issue, I think we have to reevaluate with whom we have to have a partnership relations. With whom? We see what's going on, for instance, now in Sweden. Sweden, they used to lead when it comes to the rule of law and human rights issues. Now, you see, you know what? They are not asking for even ceasefire. More than that, they stopped funding. They followed the U.S. stop or froze funding, but just recently they reactivate and refund. Also, UNRWA think this is a big thing. This is also a political position. Let me accept what the Israeli allegations. Can, for instance, now in Amsterdam, the people they joined, let me say ISIS in Syria or elsewhere, and they were staff members of the municipality of Amsterdam. Let me see, you know, how the Dutch, they have to react. They have to stop let me say, or to close the municipality. This is the way. What's this way? Even to the extreme line that what the Israelis said, it's okay. Until today, the Israelis, they didn't give even the investigation committee of the UN any evidence. They haven't cooperated with them. They are big liars. The Israeli officials, they are big liars. That's the case. And we saw what's their lies, even in 7th, when they spoke about beheaded babies and other things. Why I have to take their story and their information for granted here or there? Because of that, I ask for ICC to investigate this case. Let them go after Hamas and any Palestinians. I have no problem with that. But I need a credible system, and I need honest system, and I need a professional system, but I will not depend on the Israeli information, regarding anything or any violations. This is the case. Let's allow, for instance, the International Commission of Investigation. They have a jurisdiction over the crimes or over the violations here or there, and the root cause. This is their mission. That's the case. And any targeted of civilians, it's a crime. But there is a difference between targeted civilian by ordinary person for ordinary reason, this is a crime. Or for instance, in the context of armed conflict, here it's a war crime. And let's see what's going on in Gaza these days, in West Bank, invading, and persecuting Palestinians in West Bank, in Jenin, in everywhere. What's this? Prisoners. The Palestinian detainees, what's going on there? Where has this happened? Even the pictures that we see these days. Just tell me, where has this happened? Where you saw these things? You saw them in the Second World War. That's the case, and we have not to be shy addressing things and say, this is what's going on, and this is what happened, and this is the case, and we have to compare. We have to compare with everything to see and to show, to tell the real story, and also to speak about the double standards. I am not comparing crime with the crimes. No, I'm not comparing. But what's going on in Ukraine? Why the reactions, against the Russians? More than 700, different types of actions were taken. But here, we ask for 1% of that. Because of that, I think, and also the ICC. I don't want to repeat what my colleague Raji said in his speech. I think, but in the same time, I keep hope, and I have strong faith with the future, but unfortunately, the price, the human price, is so, so high. And if there is one has to concern from a long term, not the Palestinians.
Shawaan, very, very interesting. We are approaching the end, so I want to take, there are many questions from the audience. So I'm going to ask you to try to answer as shortly as possible, maximum 1 minute each question, if this is possible. But to try to take as many questions as possible. The first question, we know about the ICJ suit and actions. Are there other legal actions against Israel or Israeli leaders or military operatives available or underway?
I can confirm, yes. Okay. ICC is one.
Great. Clearly, this genocide would not be occurring without the support of other states, mainly the US. What legal measures are available to bring those complicit to justice?
We tried to take, because regarding the ICJ, this is something different because they have a reservation on Article 9 of the convention itself, but we try to use the domestic judiciary system in California and Oakland case. And for technical reasons, you know, they dropped the case. But also the judge, I think he used the very good and strong words in that case. And now we appeal the case. We will see. But also regarding the others and what's going on there, this is also one of the things. Because when we targeted Biden, Blinken, Austin, I think it was clear we meant it in our point of view. In my point of view, they are complicit, and more than that, they are part of the crime. They are part of the crime, not just providing weapons. And I can say more than that, yeah, they are alleged criminals, in my point of view. Okay. We'll see. I have no specific answer.
Okay. There's no question, another question from the audience. There's no question that the very top of the pyramid of Israeli leadership repeatedly expressed intent to commit genocidal acts. Is this different from the intent required in the Genocide Convention? So we have a legal question here.
Look, I think legally speaking, even the ICJ, they haven't go in merits, but when it goes to the merit, this is a long way, little bit. But I think the provisional measures, in my point of view, the ICJ gave, let me say, 40% answer when they said plausible also genocide. That's, they gave answer, and I have no doubt that the ICJ will rule. Let me keep hope that they will rule in this case. This is very important, you know, when you put the stamp, you know, in their faces that they commit genocide. I think Israel, they didn't put reservation on Article 9. This is the only treaty, the only convention that the Israeli, they didn't reserve, you know, put reservation on the ICJ rule, you know, that. That's why, because they thought that this is their convention and they will not, you know, nothing happened against them. And maybe this is part of their conscience. You know, when the Germans and the war, they said never again, maybe they thought that never again against the Israelis, not against Palestinians. It's allowed to happen against Palestinians, but not against. That's what they meant by never again. Germany, maybe this is what they meant by never again. It's not, you know, to commit things again. It's okay to commit things against Palestinians. That doesn't mean, you know, never again. That's, I think, how I look at it. And I think the ICC has also to proceed. They can't just ignore a proceeding on a genocide. Even, you know, we call the genocide as the crime of the crimes. If I want to go, you know, under the, let me say, the genocide, beside the genocide, crimes against the humanity. This is an issue. It's a big issue. Also war crimes. This is also an issue. I think there are cases, I hope and I wish to see, you know, something happened soon or in the near future.
We have a question about the torturing of prisoners. I gather that there are testimonies of those who were released to the strip after being detained in Israeli incarceration camps. What is your take on this?
We are just following and we are trying to document. And this is a big thing, but I know well that there are other organizations that are doing this business and working on these cases very well. To be honest with you, Obay, sometimes I ask myself, I say, oh, I think Israelis, they are still standing in the 48. They are like gangs. They are not state. Yani, there is some limits. you can't cross these limits. This is what I thought. I know the Israeli, let me say, culture, ideology, good, but not to this extent. I was shocked. They don't act as a state with some limits, mainly when they dealt and they treated the Palestinian detainees and prisoners. More than that, what's happened on 7th, 8th, and after that, it wasn't completed yet. And the story, it hasn't documented well. And this is a message to the journalists, to the Israeli official, to the Israeli academics, to the Israeli human rights organizations, also to document what's happened. What's happened with the workers, thousands of Palestinians, what's happened to them? How they were killed, if they killed, how they were killed? What's happened to them? Who killed them? This is a story. Who killed even the combatants? They were captured by the Israeli police or the Israeli army. What's happened to them? Exactly. No one speak about these things. Okay, you speak about 1,200 they were killed. It's okay. I can say, you know, any targeting of civilians, any targeting of civilians intentionally, this is a crime. No way to accept this. This is what the law says. We are not selective when it comes to that. But this is one. And hostages, civilian hostages has to be released. I can say this in a clear way. And I said it since the beginning. But when it comes to the soldiers, this is something else. They are prisoners of war. And the Israelis in the first day, they used this term. They said prisoners of war. But later on, they said, and they mixed things. Why you mix these things? Why you mixed these things? This is an issue for the people they have to understand what's going on and which language that they have to use.
Thank you, Shawaan. I apologize for the audience. We won't be able to cover all of the questions, but we'll hear, we'll try to send the questions for the participants and get answers and also post them on in a couple of days when the webinar is posted on the YouTube channel and the webpage of Scientists for Palestine and Bisan Center. We want to hear a final message from Raji Sourani. I asked him, what would you like our audience to carry with them? So we'll hear this recorded message. Then I have the same question for Shawaan.
Yeah, maybe, I mean, we are at the worst time ever in our history regarding the level of killing, destruction, blood. But I believe that we proven with this, we are the stones of the valley. We have been there since ever, and we will continue there forever, and no power on earth would be able to uproot us from there. If all this mighty, all this power invested, all this killing, destruction, displacement practiced over the course of 173 days and it didn't work, it will never work. We are strong enough to face this criminal belligerent occupation. But definitely, we are much stronger with the real support by free committed people across the globe, whom we know that they are standing to our side and supporting our just, fair, right cause and against all these crimes committed by the criminal occupation. We are in the right side of history. And nobody able to take the hope from our heart or our minds. We will keep our strategical optimism, and we know one day we shall overcome.
Strong message from Raji, we shall overcome. Shawaan, what can people do to support Palestine and Palestinian civil society?
I think so. I'm supporting Palestinians these days. You are supporting, you know, the global values regarding justice and equality and human rights, and also standing behind your values. It's not just standing behind the Palestinians only, even standing behind Palestinians these days and victims, you are standing behind the right values. Another thing is, in my point of view, I think Zionism is anti-Semitism, not other than that. That's the case, how I do believe. And it's, we keep a hope, and I think a future is for justice, no doubt. It's not just words, no doubt. And the human rights, it's not a picnic, and it's not a job. And I think dignity and rights, it deserves any price to pay to enjoy it. That's what I would like to say. And it's a time to work collectively. And it's a time to think also globally, not just for Palestine and Palestinians. When we stand also behind all victims and those they were persecuted by ugly regimes and ugly ideologies. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Shawaan. Thank you also for Raji, who wasn't able to be with us tonight, and for Amjad, who is now in Gaza. And we're hearing that there's intense bombing in the middle area. Hope he's okay also. Thank you for the audience, and thank you for the steering committee of Bisan lecture series.
And we have no right to give up.
Of course, we have no right to give up, and of course, we will steadfast. And as Raji said, we're the stones of the valley, so we will stay steadfast. We would like to remind everyone and encourage them to and invite them for the next lecture, which will be on April 17th at 7 p.m. Palestine time. We will be hosting Professor David Mumford from Brown and Harvard University with a very important lecture, Are Fully Intelligent Robots Coming Soon? Registration is open, and we will send an email to everyone that registered for this webinar when it's online, and hopefully we can also get some of the answers for the other questions that I apologize, but we didn't have time to get to. Thank you for everyone, and good evening.
Thank you.